Let us consider an upright stick of length L and mass m that is falling on a frictionless table. This is a frictionless table. The dotted line represents a stick. This is the point where the center of mass is. Now, when the stick is falling, this is on a table that is frictionless. So what happens is center of mass will fall along this direction and this will come to rest. The stick will come to rest. There is no horizontal force acting on the center of mass. So the stick must fall straight down. The stick rotates through an angle theta. The center of mass straight away falls down. The stick will gradually rotate through an angle theta. Now let us look at the energy of this stick. Initially, when you look at the point of the center of mass, the initial energy is kinetic energy plus potential energy, that is k0 plus u0. Initially, the kinetic energy is 0. Potential energy at the center of mass is mgh. Capital M is the mass of the stick. G is acceleration due to gravity. L by 2 is the height of the center of mass from the ground. So this is the potential energy possessed by the stick. Kinetic energy is 0. So the total energy, initial energy, is mgl by 2. That is our equation number 1. Now kinetic energy at a later time, when the stick has fallen and this angle is theta, the center of mass has come down by a distance y. Initially the center of mass was at a distance half the length, that is L by 2, because it is at the center. Now it has fallen through y. So this distance, the remaining distance, will be L by 2 minus y. This will be L by 2 minus y. If this angle is theta and this length is L by 2, this length L by 2 minus y will be equal to cos L by 2. So kinetic energy at a later stage, when it has fallen through an angle theta, is half I0 theta dot square. Theta dot is omega. Half I omega square plus half mv square. V is velocity. So y dot represents velocity. Y is the displacement. So half my dot square. So this will be the kinetic energy at a later stage. And the corresponding potential energy will be mgh. H here is L by 2 minus y. Now the center of mass is at this point, that is L by 2 minus y. So that substitution is made here. Now mechanical energy is conserved as there is no dissipative force. It is falling on a frictionless table. So from equations 1, 2 and 3, we can write this. You can combine this kinetic energy and potential energy. That will be equal to the initial total energy. That is substituted over here. Y is equal to L by 2 minus L by 2 cos theta. See, this is Y. Y is L by 2 minus this distance. If this is L by 2, this half length L by 2, this distance will also be equal to the L by 2 cos theta. That is what is written here. So differentiating it with respect to time, y dot will be L by 2 sine theta into theta dot. Cos minus cos theta becomes sine theta. So rearranging, you get theta dot is equal to 2 y dot by L sine theta. And I0 is ml square by 12. Substituting all these quantities in the expression, in this expression, you are substituting all these. And when you rearrange, you get y dot square is equal to 2gy by 1 plus 1 by 3 sine square theta. And substituting for y, you can substitute. So you get the expression for the velocity of center of mass in terms of the angular displacement theta. Now, next we are going to discuss about finite and infinite decimal rotations. Finite rotation means rotation over a particular angle. Infinitesimal means the rotation is over a very, very small angle. If you consider a translation motion, in the translation motion, the position vector r is xi plus yj plus zk. So if a and b are two vectors, you have a plus b is equal to b plus a. There is commutation. This is commutation. But if you look at the rotation through a finite angle, rotation, first look at this figure. This is a rectangular box, or you can take your own thick textbook, you take x, y and z axis. Is the rotation commutative? That is what we want to find out. You are rotating over a finite angle. You are rotating it over 90 degree, pi by 2 you are rotating. So if you are rotating over considerably large angles, is it commutative? That we are going to find out. We are going to take the same book or box and rotate it in two different ways. First, I am going to rotate it about the x-axis. I am going to rotate this book 90 degree. You can do this by taking a book in your hand and repeating the same thing as well and checking. So when you rotate by 90 degree, this is the next position. So along x-axis, you rotated by 90 degree. Now we want to rotate along y-axis by 90 degree. So this face will come down. This will rotate and this will be the position after it has rotated through y-axis also. So first it rotated along x-axis by 90 degree. Then the book rotated along the y-axis by 90 degree. So this is the new position. The same thing what will happen if rotation is commutative. The rotation of along x followed by along y. If you change the order, it should be the same. That is what is meant by commutation. So now let us see. We are going to take the same arrangement. First, we are rotating along the y-axis by 90 degree. So now this is the position. Now we are again rotating along the x-axis by 90 degree. So this is the new position. You can repeat this using your textbook or a box you take and rotate. So in these two cases, they are not similar. The position has changed. That means finite rotation does not commute. So under finite rotation, commutation is not possible. But if you look at infinitesimal rotation, infinitesimal means this rotation is over a very, very small angle. In that case, this rotation is commutative. Here you see rotation along x-axis, theta xi, plus followed by rotation along y-axis is not equal to rotation along y-axis plus rotation along x-axis. That is what we have seen in the case of rotation over finite angles. Now, if we look at infinitesimal rotation, where the rotation is very, very small angle. Suppose alpha and beta are the small angles through which you are rotating about the x and y-axis. So, alpha should be much less than 1 and beta should be much less than 1. So in that case, you get rotation alpha beta. That means first you are making the rotation alpha, then the rotation beta. That will be the same as rotation along beta, then rotation along alpha. Now let us see how we get this result. Just look at this figure. This is the x-axis, y-axis, z-axis. This is the vector r. Now we are going to rotate this vector r. Vector r is along x. So vector r is magnitude r into I because it is along the x direction. We have considered a vector like this. Now this is rotating along the about the z axis. You are making one rotation. About the z axis, it is rotating. Now the component, this vector has rotated and now the position is r alpha. It has rotated through a small angle alpha. So now the component of this vector ra will be, this will be r cos alpha I. You look at the component. This will be r cos alpha I plus r sin alpha j. This will be equal to, this will be r sin alpha j. So the magnitude of RA is equal to magnitude of R is equal to R, because the magnitude has not changed. Now the second rotation. Now we are going to rotate through an angle beta about the y axis. First we rotated along z axis. Now we are going to rotate along the y axis. This is the y axis. We are rotating this through an angle beta. First it rotated like this. Now it is rotating like this about the y axis. This is the angle beta through which it is rotating. So now the component of this vector. Let us look at what happens. This component, because rotation is along y axis, the y component will not change. Only the x component will change. So r sin alpha j will not change. It will remain as such. This component changes to the magnitude will remain as r cos alpha, plus there will be a term containing, just like you resolve this into the cos of this angle and sine of this angle. Similarly, here also we'll have to resolve the component of r alpha in terms of cos and sine of beta. That is what you get here. R cos alpha comes here in the place of the magnitude r. Here the magnitude will be r cos alpha, because the vector that is rotated is, it is not the vector r but ra that is rotating through an angle beta. So you will get r cos alpha cos beta I minus sine beta k. Minus sign is coming because this is rotating towards the negative z axis. This component is along the negative z axis. So you get this. Remove the bracket. This is what you get. Now we are going to reverse the order of the rotation. Here first we rotated through z axis, then through y axis. Now we are going to first rotate through y axis and then through z axis. So in that case, similarly you can write down the components and you'll get r beta alpha. First you rotate it through beta, then through alpha, you get as r cos alpha cos beta I plus r cos beta sin alpha j minus r sin beta k. So in this equations 1 and 2, these angles alpha and beta are considered to be infinitesimal rotation. It is not finite rotation, very very small rotation. So what happens is, when the angle is very small, much less than 1, we get for small angles sine theta is of the order of theta. So sine delta theta becomes approximately delta theta. Instead of alpha, now it has become very small, that is delta alpha. And cos of that small angle becomes equal to 1. So these substitutions when we make, we get r alpha beta is equal to, just look at here, r, you get r I r delta alpha j minus r delta beta k, because cos term will be equal to 1 and sine term reduces to that angle. Similarly, the expression r beta alpha becomes ri plus r delta alpha j minus r delta beta k. Now you look at these two expressions, we get the result that r alpha beta equal to r beta alpha. So this shows that infinitesimal rotation is commutative. So in order to find out the total rotation delta theta, that is the total angle through which it has rotated, we are taking the rotation, the small rotation delta beta plus delta alpha. Delta beta along the y-axis and delta alpha along the z-axis. So this will give you the vector angle delta theta. Now if you take the cross product delta theta cross r, what is r? R is ri. If you take the cross product delta theta cross r, what you get will be R is having only I component. So J cross I will be K. So delta beta K and delta alpha K in cross R will be, cross I will be, you'll have J component. So you look at this expression. The displacement delta R is R final minus R initial. R final is R alpha beta. Initially it was Ri. Initially the vector was Ri. This was the initial vector Ri. Final vector is R beta alpha beta. So you write down the expression for alpha, R alpha beta. R alpha beta is this one. Minus Ri. Substitute for minus Ri. So it simplifies and you get the expression, which is equal to delta theta cross R. Now, if the displacement is over a very small time delta t, the velocity v is dr by dt. So in the limiting case, you get delta theta cross R by delta t, which is equal to omega cross R. So you get linear velocity v is equal to omega cross R.